Hello everyone, God bless you. Pastor David here with you once again. I'd like to welcome you to our Wednesday devotion. I hope and pray that each and every one of you are blessed. You are blessed within your home, blessed within your families, and blessed within God more than anything. As I said, I'd like to welcome you to our Wednesday devotion. I'd like to read out of John chapter 10, verse 9. I love this verse. I know I say that pretty much out of about each and every verse that I've read here, but this one really is it's a very powerful verse. And John chapter 10 verse 9, it says, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pastures." You know, there are seven words that we can use, if I can use this word, to expound on this small but yet very powerful verse. The first one is declaration. And I'll just tell you the words that I want to use before we actually go into what it is that we're going to be speaking of. There's declaration, there's exclusion, there's invitation, there's condition, there's salvation, there's liberation, and there's provision. All those seven words within this small little verse. If we see where Jesus Christ said, "I am the door," that is Him declaring who He is, and that's the best thing about our Lord Jesus Christ, is that He knew who He was. He knew why His Father had sent Him. He knew who He was. He knew the purpose of why He had come here on earth, and the mission that He was on. As I said, why His Father had sent Him. And by Him saying, "I am the door," or depending on the version that you read, "I am the gate," He also says, he is saying, "I know who I am, and I know why I have come." And He knew He was the door. And even when He says, whosoever, that's everyone. That's everyone. That is everyone that has ever existed, that is existing right now, and anyone that will ever exist and will, still even comes until the Lord Jesus Christ comes for us. So when He says whosoever or whoever, He's not excluding anyone. He's not excluding anyone. We even see that in John 3:16, where Jesus Himself also says that for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, and again, whosoever believes in Him. And here we find Jesus saying, "Whoever enters through me." So again, we find that word "whoever," and basically by that, He's saying, anyone. It's an invitation that He's putting out there. It's not, "I'm only going to invite you. I'm only going to invite you because I like you. I don't like you." No. God doesn't work that way. God isn't, I'll even go as far as to say that God isn't like us. And I am so thankful that God is not like us, but it is an open invitation. We have to make that decision. Each and every one of us. I made that decision when I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. My wife made that decision. My son, my daughter. If I could have done it for them, I would love to have done it for them, to guarantee that they got into heaven. But we, as individuals, as believers, each and every one of us have to make that decision. But that invitation is out there. Just the same way that you that are watching and listening to this video, if you have accepted our Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then you accepted that invitation. We also see where He says, "Whosoever enters." There's a condition. He does place conditions. Many times we as believers, and I'll even go as far as to say as humans, we try to serve God conditionally. God, if you do this for me, then I will serve you. If you do this for me, I will be sold out for you. If you do this for me, I will go into the world and preach the gospel. If you do this, and that's not the right way to serve God. If we're going to serve God, we're going to serve Him no matter what. because God loves us unconditionally. He doesn't love us only because we do good things or because we're good people or we're nice to each other. No, He loves us unconditionally. He doesn't love the sin that we're in. And that's why the Bible says that yet as sinners, Jesus died on the cross for us. Again, there's that invitation. We also see where He says, through me. It's an exclusion. As I mentioned earlier, exclusion. There is an exclusion. He's not excluding anybody. But when I say exclusion, what I'm talking about is that there is an exclusion, that there is no other way to get to heaven except through Him. There is no way to get to the Father except through Him. He is the only way. And in this case, He is the only door. He's the only gate to get to the Father. And that another I am is when Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And once again, we find it, but in a different way, when He says, I am the gate, whoever enters through me. So right there, we've already seen three. We've seen the declaration, we've seen the exclusion, and we've seen the invitation, actually four. The declaration, the exclusion, the invitation, and the condition. And then we see the salvation, where He says, I am the gate, whoever enters through me will be saved. So He knows why He has come, and He knows who He is and what He is here to do. And it is to save the world. And that's why He came. He came that we may have salvation, that we may have life. He Himself said it, that He comes to give life and life more abundantly, because the enemy comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But He has come that we may have life and have it more abundantly. You know, again, He knew who He was and who He is and why He had come. So we see that He says, I am the door. Whoever enters through me, whoever comes through me will be saved. But then it also says, and you will go in, you shall go in and come out. You will be able to go in and go out. That's liberation. When the Bible says, if the Son has set you free, then you will be free indeed. You know, and that is something so wonderful. That is something so beautiful. And it shows us, but we cannot have that freedom. We cannot have that liberation without coming to our Lord Jesus Christ first. We cannot have that liberation. We cannot have that freedom without giving our life to Him and accepting Him and allowing Him to come into our hearts, come into our lives. Even a verse, you know, one of the verses that I read these past few weeks where it says, I stand at the door and I knock. And whoever opens whoever hears my voice and opens the door. So we have to do that. We have to open up the door for Him. But here's another way that He explains it, another analogy, another parable, not a parable, it's not a story, but another analogy that He uses when He says, I am the door. Anyone who enters through me will be saved, and they will be able to go in and go out. And then He finishes by saying, and they will find good pastures, and they will find pastures. You know, and that's God's provision. That's provision right there. You know, and we might say, because nowadays, you know, I'm a self-made man. Everything that I have because I've worked hard for it. Yes, but who is it that provides everything for you to be able to wake up early in the morning? Who is it that gives you the strength? Who is it that gives you the peace of mind? Who is it that gives you the ability to be able to do what it is that you do? It's only through God, and it's only through Him. And that provision comes only when we have accepted Him into our heart, into our life, and we allow God to move within us. And that is such a wonderful thing. Now, very quickly, I'm just going to cover these three things. It's the three results that we have of Jesus Christ being the door. First of all, as we mentioned, He is the door, and He Himself says, anyone who enters through me will be saved. So we have salvation. We have salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He forgives us of our sins. He gives us eternal life. He allows us to enter into heaven, and He makes us children of God. Because of that salvation, and as I mentioned earlier, He knows who He is, and He knows why He came. So there is a purpose. God is very intentional, and I will always say this, and I will continue to say this, that God is very intentional in everything that He does. And our Lord Jesus Christ, he himself said that anyone who enters through him will be saved. Anyone that goes through him shall receive the eternal life. So because of him, we are forgiven because of the blood that he shed on the cross. That blood was shed for the redemption of our sins. And because of that, we're able to have and receive the promise of eternal life. We're able to enter into heaven and we become children of God. And that is such a wonderful thing that we can have as believers. Another thing, we're able to have access to the benefits that God has, that God offers, which is to enjoy the riches of Christ, to study and enjoy the scriptures and to pray and worship with freedom. You know, to enjoy the riches of Christ. When I say that, I know maybe a lot of people might think, oh my God, is Pastor David talking about money? Is Pastor David talking that now I'm not going to have to struggle financially? That's not what I'm talking about. When I say to enjoy the riches of Christ, I'm talking about even he himself said when he came, that he comes to give life and life more abundantly. There's so many more things. I mean, we're talking about happiness. We're talking about joy within our lives. We're talking about healing that we gain whenever we have him in our lives. The Bible says that by his stripes we are healed, that he is our Jehovah Rapha, our healer. And now more than ever, with everything that's going on, with so many people that are out there needing salvation and needing healing, We have our Lord Jesus Christ to call out to and go to, and we know that he is our healer. Not only that, but he is our provider. He is our strength. He is the peace giver. He is love, you know, within itself. So when I say riches, I'm not necessarily talking about you know, the financial part of it. I'm talking about everything else that comes with serving God. When I also said to study and enjoy the scriptures, I know that pretty much anybody can, if they want to, they can read the Bible but if they do not have the guidance of God, the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the ability to be able to ask God, enlighten me, God, show me, open my eyes, open my heart, open my spirit, and that I may receive what you have for me within your word. You know, if we don't do that, then we're just going to read the Bible and it's just going to be words. And we might even say, wow, it's beautiful words, very encouraging. Yes, but the Word of God is living. The Word of God is effective and it continues to be living and it continues to be effective to each and every one of us. And we have to understand that. We have to understand that each and every time that we pray, each and every time that we read the Bible, we have to pray and we have to tell the Lord, Lord, show me, speak to my life, speak to my heart, show me what it is that you have for me today when I read your word. So we have to know that. And we also have the freedom to be able to pray and worship with that freedom, you know, because even our Lord Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross and at the very end, when he said it is finished, the Bible says that, and I mentioned this a couple of Sundays ago, and I think I even mentioned it this past Sunday, that the earth shook and that the temple veil was torn in two, and that gives us direct contact, direct access to God, to the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. And it gives us a freedom to be able to pray and know that God is listening, and the freedom to be able to worship and know that when we worship, and not just in songs, because a lot of people think worship is in songs because of praise and worship, but just telling God throughout the day, Lord, I worship you. Lord, I praise you. And everything that you do, Lord, I thank you for everything that you've done in my life. You know, that's worshiping God. And we have to be true worshipers, because the Bible says that the day will come when he is looking for worshipers to worship him in spirit and in truth. And with this, I'll be done. And the last thing, even when it says that we will be able to go out and come in, go out and come in to do what? To do what? To live for Christ, to be witnesses for Christ, to serve others. You know, we have been called. The Bible says, and I read that this past Sunday, that we have been called to be a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. To do what? to declare the greatness of God, that he has brought us out of the darkness. He's called us to do great and mighty things for him, through the Holy Spirit, through our Lord Jesus Christ working within us, that power, as I mentioned on Sunday, that power that works within us. You know, and when we begin to do that, we're going to be able to serve others, and we're going to be able to do it, you know, so freely and know that God is there. So we're able to go out, you know, not just to serve ourselves, but actually to serve others, not just to enjoy ourselves, but actually to do great and mighty things for God, to be a witness for God, with everything that he has done. If God has done great things in your life, don't stay quiet about it. Tell people, let people know what God has done, because there's people that are out there that need to know what God has done in your life, because God can do that great and mighty work in their lives as well. I'd like to pray with you right now. And if there's anyone, first of all, if there's anyone that has never accepted Christ into their hearts as your personal Savior, I'd like for you to repeat this prayer with me. And just know that our Lord Jesus Christ is ready and willing, that God is ready and willing to hear your prayers and to forgive you of your sins. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I praise you. I worship you. I recognize the need that I have for you in my life. And I ask you to forgive me. Cleanse me. That blood that you shed on the cross, I know that you shed it for me to redeem my sins. You paid the price for my sins. And I thank you for that. I ask you to forgive me. That you come into my heart. Come into my life. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. I thank you. I thank you for what you've done, what you're doing, and what you're going to continue to do. Give me the strength to be able to continue forward. Give me the wisdom to be able to trust in you. And give me the peace in my heart to know that you're going to be there, Mom. But now I also ask, my Lord Jesus, for everyone else that is listening and watching this video, I ask you for them. I ask you to go to where they are, touch their lives, be with them, strengthen them. Oh God, if there's anyone that needs healing right now, we unite together. I unite together with you, with them, in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus, and proclaim healing upon your life. If you need strength, I proclaim strength in your life. If you need peace, I proclaim peace in your life. Call out to him and know that he's there and ready and willing to listen to each and every one of you. And my Lord God, I ask you that you hear those prayers, because I know that your word says, call on me and I will answer you. And you're ready and willing to answer each and every one of those prayers. But I thank you for being that door, as we spoke on today, that whosoever enters will be saved. And I thank you for that wonderful promise, Lord God. And I ask you to be with us in everything that we do. And I thank you for what you've done, what you're doing, what you're going to continue to do in our lives, in our homes, within our churches. In your holy and precious name, amen. Amen. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. And I hope and pray that this devotion has been of a blessing to your life. And I hope and pray that you will continue to trust in God in everything that you do. Amen. Have a rest. The rest of this week, I hope and pray that it is a blessed week, and I hope and pray that it is a victorious week. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.